It is a great honor for me to introduce our speaker today, who has always championed the rights of black people. Our speaker would like to acknowledge the splendid invitation extended to him by the students, faculty, and members of Michigan State University. As a youth, he fought his way to the top to become Olympic heavyweight champion and later champion of the world, with a string of 28 victories, 22 of these by knockout. The day before he won the heavyweight championship, he proclaimed membership to the Black Muslim movement and reclaimed his black dignity as Muhammad Ali. In 1966, he toured Africa and was warmly welcomed by Muslims the world over. His topics today shall deal with integration, separation, politics, and violence. It is with great pride that I present the Honorable Muhammad Ali.
I've been facing crowds all of my life, ever since I was 12 years old, ever since I entered the Golden Gloves in a town called Louisville, Kentucky. Some of you probably heard of it. But now I'm facing crowds a little different from boxing, because usually I didn't see nobody but my opponent. I didn't have time to look at the crowd. The audience is black, it's dark, and the light is in the ring, so you usually don't see the people. So this is a different thing now. I'm on a 150 college tour, and this is about my 15th college this season. And many people ask me, what do you talk about on various TV shows? What do you talk about when you're at colleges? And I'm here today, and I'm sure you are here, because we all are conscious of the fact that we have a problem, a serious problem, whether we be black or white. And as the brother just said who introduced me, I'm here to speak on integration, violence, separation, and politics. Which is the solution to this problem that we have here in America, which is the worst problem on the planet Earth? And that's the conflict between the black and white Americans. As a matter of fact, we're living in a time of world trouble. When you look at the news, you see no good news. All of the news is bad news. And your worst problem on this whole planet Earth is between the slave and the master. This problem in America is worse than the Catholic Protestant problem. This problem in America between the black and the white is worse than the Israeli-Egyptian problem. This problem in America is worse than the Biafran-Nigerian problem. This problem in America is worse than the North and the South in Vietnam. You might ask, why is it so serious? Why is this problem worse than all of these critical problems which cost billions of dollars a day just to stay in them? What makes this problem so bad with America and her 400-year-old slaves? Number one, for the simple fact, this is a 400-year-old problem. And now this is 1970, this is the moon age, and the problem is getting worse. Problem is getting worse today. Now and today, people want to know what's the best solution. All intelligent people, those of us who are civilized, black and white, we are looking for a peaceful solution. We have tried everything and it's done failed. Black folks done walked in, swimmed in, sat in, crawled in, laid in, and still getting their heads whooped in. Some believe that integration will solve the problem in America. Some believe that politics will solve the problem in America. We have some who believe that one day after we all integrate, after the black folks and the white folks all marry each other, one day we'll be all the same color. He's dreaming. Some believe that violence is the solution. We should get some machine guns and some rifles and just have a showdown, a physical confrontation with white America. Some believe that's going to straighten things out. And some believe the total separation of the races, black people being separate in their own nation, is the solution. Now, all of you, I'm sure you wouldn't be here today if you didn't have common sense. You understand? You at least got common sense. And what I'm going to say is plain and is true. As Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and truth alone will make you free. He didn't say open housing. He didn't say integration. He didn't say education. No, he didn't say Lincoln or Nixon or Agnew. He said truth will free you. And black folks sure not free today. And white America will never have peace and real freedom until she recognizes the truth. She knows it, but she don't want to tell the slave the truth. So we're going to check over all of these programs, and I'm going to be finished, and then I understand later we're going to have a question and answer period. We're going to go into integration. We've taken it to the laboratory, and we're going to check it out. We're going to check out violence and the possibilities of this solving it. We're going to check out politics and everything combined with what black people are doing today and white people to change this thing. As far as integration is concerned, I'm sure that all white women and white men in this audience today, in his or her right white mind, don't want black boys and black girls coming around your home, schools, and churches looking to marry your white sons and daughters, and in return introducing your grandchildren as half-brown, kinky-haired Negroes. I know you don't want it. Same for black people. I'm sure no intelligent black man or black woman here with the afros and the black pride, I'm sure they don't want white boys and white girls coming to marry their black sons and daughters and in return introducing their grandchildren as half white, green-eyed, blonde-haired Negroes. This is not racism, this is not hate, this is truth. Every man loves a son who look like himself. God made us in nations, families, and tribes. Some people he made black, some he made white, some he made brown, some he made every color. He mixed them all up good, and I'm sure he made no mistake in his creation. He beautified the planet Earth by separating all the people on different continents to themselves. You find the Chinese in China. You find the Puerto Ricans in Puerto Rico. You find the Hawaiians in Hawaii. Right? Everything gonna be with his own. Now, if you just notice how you see a bunch of black folks sitting right here, they don't hate nobody. They just like to be with their own kind. They talk different. They sing different. They dance different. Everything gonna be with his own. But a Christian Negro who has never heard the truth. Integration. Integration will weaken black people. When I want a strong cup of coffee, I take it black. When I make it weak, I integrate it. I put some cream in it. We have tried integration. Integration today, 1970, has failed to solve the race problem. If a rocket ship, if some visitors from another planet landed here in America in 1960 and listened to the news, and if they went away and stayed 10 years and came back today and turned on the radio and listened to the news, they think time has stood still. Here it is, 1970, and they're on television arguing about schools, integration, and the government saying, well, we're rushing it, and take your time now, we can... We rushing it. I'm not for no integration in this type way. No, I mean, this is not the solution to the problem. I'm just saying, for those who believe it, they're still fighting for something the same way they were talking 10, 20 years ago. All the preachers of integration are dead in the graveyard, or they are powerless. Certain black leaders who represent integration have no power today. It's the militants, it's the separatists today that stay in the news. They're the ones that sell the million-dollar books on their lives. They're the ones who they make movies about. Now black people today are through fighting for integration as a whole. They're no longer dying to get into white restaurants. They found out when they got in the restaurant, they didn't like the food, they didn't like the music on the jukebox. So man, we done took all that head whooping for nothing. Ain't nothing happening in, man, shoot. Ain't nothing happening in here. Now the black man wants black history. Now he wants you to call him black. Call him black 5 years ago, he'd cut you. Now he'll cut you if you don't call him black. You understand? We used to call each other your old nappy head African nigga. Now we want to be like the Africans. So integration and all of this is failed. And I want to talk as plain as I can where we all can follow. I understand we got people who have different races, creeds, and colors, different religious beliefs. And I want to stay in the frame. I want to stay where everybody can understand. Now, how many people in here today, I want to ask you a question or two before I leave the topic of integration. How many believe that intermarriage is the thing we should do and all of us mix up our blood and lose identity? And all type bastard children running around, or how many think that integration in one day we're gonna all live together and go to school together and worship together? I mean, this integration takes in, we just all equal and this is the solution to black people's problem. Raise your hand. All right, now that kills integration. Now let's go on another topic here. Now, I'm not saying this for violence. I'm saying there's no future. See, what we must understand, black and white are two opposites. And opposite means something that's 100 degrees different from another. See, the opposite of high is low. The opposite of right is wrong. The opposite of wet is dry. The opposite of hot is cold. The opposite of black is white. And if something is your opposite, what does that make it? It's 100 degrees different. If it's your opposite, it's your opposition. If it's your opposition, that automatically makes it your opposer. If it's your opposer, it's your opponent. And by nature, black and white have been opponents to one another for 400 years. Can't get along. Constantly. And today getting worse. It's so bad until even America's former enemies are more freer than the so-called Negroes. The black man died and fought for America to beat the Japanese. Now the Japanese is more freer than me. In America, the Germans, the Koreans, and a day after the war in Vietnam, the Viet Cong will be more free than Negroes in America. And I couldn't holler so loud and bold if it wasn't the truth. And if you think I'm lying, get up and challenge me when this is over. So two people being 100 degrees difference, two people being completely opposite, sing different, dance different, talk different, socialize different, dress different, you understand? Two people who are opposed to one another by nature can never get along in peace. So we're going to take a look at politics now that we've come to the conclusion that intermarriage and integration and all this foolishness ain't gonna do it. We're gonna look at politics. Some people believe that after we get some more black mayors and probably a few thousand years from now, black men might luck up and get in the White House, he can free us. But they still are wrong, because black people will never control no white man's politics. He'll never write the laws. The white man has got books that we'll never see on law. He changes them when he's ready. Politics won't solve black people's problem. We have a dope problem politics don't have a program for. We have a lack of unity among self problem that politics will not solve. We have a disrespect for our women that politics don't preach. So politics ain't gonna solve the black people's problem. Whenever a good white man comes along who seemed like he wanna do some good, they shoot him. Lincoln wanted to do something for blacks and bumped him off. We had to wait another 100 years for the Kennedy brothers who seemed to really wanna help black folks, bumped them off. So in politics, our freedom is decided over a bullet. You understand? If politics had the solution, which it don't. Mae Evers, Martin Luther King, and all of Miss Viola Lewsaw, and all of the people who wanted to be political and work within the system to free black folks, they are dead. So politics don't have the solution to black people's problem. And I like to say, all of you here who believe that politics and black people getting in government is going to solve our problems and really free us, white and black, those of you who believe that politics will straighten black people out and all of their problems, lack of knowledge of self, know nothing about our culture, our history, we don't know our names, we got white folks' names, we look like Africans with white names. I met a brother the other day, I'm not going to say the college, he was the head of Afro-American group, and his name was George Washington. And this is a problem that we have to straighten out. We want to be called black, we want to look black, but we got the white name. All of you believe that politics is going to straighten all this out, hold your hands up. Well, that killed politics. Now let me look at another one now. You realize what I'm doing now, you agreeing with me. After you hear it, you telling me that integration ain't gonna do. You telling me that politics ain't gonna do. So think about it now. Some of us think that, and then we actually have people of my kind and white. I'm riding the plane every day and white fellows come up to me talking so liberal. Well, how you doing, champ? Or, you know, things are getting better. Let's see. He's talking, feeling me, I see where I'm at, you know. Jim Brown, them got a few things going, and Negroes can now eat down south, and you look, the worst times you couldn't ride first class on the jet. And I look at him so mad. Here, I'm wanting to own the jet, and he's talking about riding first class on the jet. One day you won't know who's who. Everybody's gonna be the same color. We all gonna be Americans when integration gets started. Now, I won't even go into that. I know that don't make no sense. How many of you believe that'll solve it? One day we're all gonna be the same color and that's gonna happen 2000, whatever they say, years from now, all that. How many believe that's gonna happen? Stand up. I just don't see what you look like. Sit down. Okay. You gotta wait 2,000 more years, so I wanna be free now. We've been waiting too long. Let me see, we done killed integration. We done killed that intermarriage foolishness. We done killed politics. Now, some people believe that the solution to the problem is physical confrontation. Well, let's go in and analyze violence. Violence. Now, America, nobody can be no more dissatisfied with injustices than Muhammad Ali. I've turned down about $15 million in commercials, advertisements, movies, endorsements, and heavyweight title fights because of, you know, my feelings on injustice and wanting to take a stand and quit Uncle Tommy and go and do what I want to do, say what I want to say. That's why I can do it now because I have no bosses to go to tomorrow, not one white man in my life to tell me when to go, what to do. And you don't know how what kind of feeling that is when you only have no boss. No boss. I say what I want. I flew in by myself, leave him by myself, and tell my agent, who's Jewish, when I'm going to go and when I ain't going to go. You understand? It costs me, but I'm free. It costs me. Can't get too many black folks in my shoes to stand up and talk like this today. I might donate a few dollars to some civil rights movement, but they better not really get up and tell no truth. If they want to stay on TV and stay in basketball or baseball or what it, movies or whatever it is. They can't really be free. They all think like this because when they get me behind the doors, they all tell me, brother, we with you, but you know, you got to get that dough. Dough don't mean nothing to me. The freedom of black folks come to me before money. That's why we know what a day, because whenever one of us get a few million, he get him a white girl and go somewhere and let them niggas make it like me. After hearing Elijah Muhammad and the Muslim teaching, that's the only thing that really straightened me out. After I heard the truth, I just couldn't sell my people's flesh and blood because I could be rich, you understand? So I can tell it like it is. So as far as being dissatisfied and wanting to get a gun, nobody can be madder than myself. And at the same time, I'm not a fool. See, a wise warrior tries to win a battle with as less casualties as possible. And America is the most powerful military country on the planet. America's spending some $20 million a day in war, and she's still strong, you understand? And me and my little pop gun on some rooftop ain't gonna do no damage. You understand? If black folks had a machine gun, a year's round of ammunition, bazookas, hanginades, all type heavy artillery, enough ammunition for 10 years and a good hideout, we wouldn't stand a chance. Being violent with white America, because we can't fly none of those supersonic electronic phantom jets. One of them little old jets, Jack, they can go faster than sound and drop a bomb and tear up a whole city. You understand? So violence with America, that wouldn't be no violence, that'd be a slaughter. Like one of you fellas running up on the stage trying to fight me. That wouldn't be that wouldn't be no violence, you'd be in trouble. Trouble. Yeah, before you run up here, you would stand the easier chance in Vietnam with a BB gun. If you dreamed it, you better wake up and apologize. That's just that impossible if you try to whoop me. Now you would stand a better chance with me than black folks would as a whole fighting white America. You understand? I might trip or I might get sick, anything can happen before you get up here. But you understand? And plus, we are 30 million people to almost 180 million. Physical revolution. The white man makes the bullets. You got guns we've never seen. You have some things where you can shoot some foam in a room, some powder, and once we inhale it, we become unconscious and can't even think straight. America's so smart. How's black people gonna win a war or plan violence against a country that's done gone to the moon, landed on the moon, walked around on the moon, hopped around on the moon, took off and met another ship which was orbiting the moon waiting for them, landed on that ship, and timed when they would leave the moon to meet the Earth. The Earth is right here, the moon is right here, and you shoot that way, and you time the Earth, and pick the spot that you're gonna land in the ocean before you took off, missed the spot about a mile or two. America's so powerful and so wise. Now I'm gonna get me a dashiki and afro and a little old rifle and hide up in some little old ghetto building. I'm about revolution, brother! Shoot that airplane, pop! Pop, pop, pop. At the same time, I'm not a cheek turner. The followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad don't take no mess and don't nobody mess with us. We don't carry no weapons. We're not looking for trouble. I'm not chasing nobody else's woman. I'm not wanting to go where you don't want me. I'm too proud for that. I've been taught I was the greatest, and how good black is now. I'm too ashamed to be crawling and begging you to get in your toilet with you. We want the same rights in that toilet as you. Ain't that a shame? We want to eat with you. We want to go to school. We want to marry you. No, after hearing the truth, I don't want that. See, I'm free. I found out how pretty black is. I found out that the richest dirt is the black dirt. I found out that the whole wheat rye bread is more expensive than the white bread. I found out that the brown sugar is better for cooking, gives you less cavities than the white sugar. I found out the blacker the berry was, the sweeter the juice. I done found out how good black was. Now I'm not dying to integrate. I'm dying to integrate with my own now. But when you had me thinking Jesus was white, I looked at Jesus, he looked just like white folks. Long blonde hair and blue eyes. I look at the Lord's Supper, look just like all white people. Bunch of hippies. I look at the angels in heaven, all white people. No black angels. And then what happened to the black angels when they took all those pictures? Oh, I know what happened. The black angels was in the kitchen preparing the milk and honey. Everything was white. Miss Universe was white. Miss America was white. Miss World was white. Even Tarzan, the king of black Africa, he was white. Can you imagine a white man swinging around Africa with a diaper on, ruling all of the Africans, breaking the lion's jaw? He's been there for a few days and he can talk to the animals. But the African been there for centuries and he don't yet know how to talk to the animals. Tarzan can talk to the animals. Brainwashed all these black folks. Black folks is brainwashed, and now we done heard the truth. We're not dying to integrate no more. So now, what is the solution? Am I closing? What is the solution to the problem? You've agreed? Oh, I forgot to ask you. Now, how many think the physical confrontation, black folks getting some pistols and some rifles, because we ain't going to get no more weapons. We ain't going to get, we don't have to fly no supersonic jets. We can't get to them if we could fly them. How many think that the physical revolution among black folks is going to get their freedom in America? Raise your hand. Who raised their hand over that saying that black folks can physically get some guns and whoop America? Raise your hand. Stand up. Boy, you my enemy. You want to get me killed, don't you? You encouraging me to do that? Okay, it's just one. We don't see him. It's 2 minutes. Everybody has got... You're not as dumb as you look, fella. You just acting crazy over there. Okay, if we've agreed that integration will not solve it. We've agreed that physical violence ain't going to do nothing. There's no chance. We've agreed that this intermarriage thing, you don't want that. And we agree that politics ain't going to do it. So what's going to solve the problem now? Remember now, you're on the spot. Integration, we can't talk about that. We can't talk about the violence. We can't talk about the politics. Now, what do you think is going to solve it? The solution to your problem, and this scares white America to death. I go to colleges every day, and it's only one question that scares white people, and that's separation. Black folks, totally geographically separating from white people. We want equality, right? Only separation can bring equality. I can't be your equal working in your factory until I have a factory. I can't be your equal working in your on your farm until I have a farm. I cannot be your equal. Now, I'm not talking about segregation. Some of you are going to say, well, you believe like Governor Wallace and the people in the South. No, they believe in segregation. See, there's a difference in separation and segregation. Segregation is when I'm in your house and you have your foot on me telling me when to come in and when not to come in, who to bring and who not to bring. See, you can segregate your children. As long as you feed them, as long as they're under your name, as long as you're clothing them, they're in your house. You can tell that child what room to go in, what room not to go in. You can tell that child who to bring there, who not to bring, where to eat and where not to eat in that house. I told my daughter the other day, Miriam, she's 2 years old, gave her a good whooping because she was eating she was eating some ice cream sandwich on my new gold couch. I beat her and whooped her. And every time she get near that couch, she back away because she know when she's eating. See, I'm training her. Every time she get on that couch, I go get a piece of paper and wrap it up and hit my leg like that. And after that comes a whooping. So whenever she start do wrong, I just, she straighten up. I can segregate that child. But as soon as my daughter get grown, find her husband, and they buy them a house and furnish them a house, she can tell daddy who to bring to that house and who not to. You can tell your mother and father, look, I don't like that man, he's a drunk, stay out of here around my children. And your father, nature tells him to turn around and leave. He says, I'm your daddy, I'll come in here like you. No, it's his, your house. See, you have black people in your house, America, with 50 rooms in it, 50 states. You tell us where to go, where not to go, how to do. I can't be mad at that. Just let me leave, and I can build me a house. Now, don't give me nothing, because we worked 400 years for nothing for white America. We worked from sun up to sundown, 16 hours a day, which enabled America to be 50 of the richest states on the planet. We fought in the Japanese War, the Korean War, the German War, and we still died in Vietnam to keep America free, not me. Now, I could go to Vietnam tomorrow and fight to free somebody I don't know, but that ain't gonna free me here. You understand? So I want to be free. See, I'm on the way to jail now because I want to go to Vietnam to shoot some black folks and never lynch me, never rape me, never put dogs on me, never lynch my mother and father, never worked me 400 years, never assassinated my leaders, and they black. I got to go shoot them. America gets in trouble, she runs the black folks and holler, we at war. You at war, not me. Now I'm a criminal because I won't go to America to shoot some black folks and never lynch me, never rape me, never slave me. I gotta go shoot them to help America keep the country that she took from my red brother, the Indian. And then after taking the Indian, she still wasn't satisfied. She went to Africa and stole me, then brought me over here and stole my name, stole my language, stole my culture, stole my God, stole my religion. Now I'm a criminal because I won't help them keep the country that they took from the Indian. Now who gonna judge America? There's no justice here for black folks. Black Panthers, anybody who's tired of police, young cracker police, joining police force just to shoot a nigga, hiding and waiting for him, pull out on him and stop him and make him say something to shoot him. Now they get tired and they figure they want to shoot back. Just gonna shoot me for nothing, I'm gonna shoot too. So now you make all kind of secret plots to get them out of the way and slip in on them and shoot them into sleep and all that. No justice, even those like Martin Luther King and everybody who really loved white folks, who wanted to integrate, they did. So what is the solution when a man and a woman can't get along, they're fussing and fighting night and day? They go to the judge and they separate. Judge, I'm gonna kill that man. Please let me leave before we kill each other. And American white people and black people have been fighting for 400 years and they still can't get along, will never get along, and will never have equality. So now that we're educated, now that we are doctors, now that we are lawyers, now that we are technicians, let us go and build us a nation and not always lay here begging you for bread, begging you for clothes, begging you to go to your school, begging you to marry you. Let us go. We intelligent. I'm civilized. We're the real builders of the planet, black people. We built was building before white people knew America was here. We can do for ourselves like you do. Black people are so educated today, they can build this whole campus without a white hand. We so good at construction work. Black people can put in all the electricity in this building without a white hand. Black people can put in the plumber in work. Now what do we need? We need some land. No people can be free or have independence without land. The value of land is the factor for more wars than any other cause. Economics will agree that for any type of a nation, system, government, communism, democracy, or what have you, in order for them to have a degree of independence, there must be ownership of land, and we are 30 million people and don't have 2 feet of earth that we can call ours. Now, what do you think the solution is? Now we're going to see how many hypocrites we got in here, with white and black. I'm going to ask you one more question, I'm through. How many people believe that the solution, the program black people should have today is number one, respecting and cleaning up themselves, cleaning up their own neighborhoods before forcing themselves into white neighborhoods? How many believe that this is the solution? And those who can better their lives, move and go where they want as long as they're welcome and not forced out, or forcing their way in. We are integrated. We have to live here. We have to ride your airplanes. We have to eat your food. You make our combs, our toothpaste, our toothpicks. We don't produce nothing. 30 million people, if the white man closed all grocery stores tomorrow, we'll starve to death. 30 million people and we don't make buttons for a shirt. 30 million people and don't make shoestrings. A whole nation of people full of colleges and don't produce none of their necessities. We are consumers and not the producers of our needs. People like Cuba and other countries who are less than population than 30 million black people govern themselves. Africans come to America, get half the knowledge we get as black people, go back and run a nation. We get all kind of degrees and diplomas, and we out shining shoes or looking for a job because we never was taught to do for self. All believe that black folks should separate, do for self, run their own stores, grow their own food, make their own laws, make their own airplanes. I'm thinking big, I'm not jiving. Run your own bus lines. All believe that black folks should respect and protect their women, quit beating and mistreating and prostituting the women. See, anybody can come to a black neighborhood and use our system. I see it, I travel more than anybody from coast to coast every day. Mainly white men come to black neighborhoods and look for the black woman. And the black men can stand on the corner, watch the white man carry to a motel, and won't even kick the door or throw a rock at the car, won't even do nothing to show that he don't like it. And then we wonder why we don't get respect. Elijah Muhammad teaches us that we'll never be respected until we first respect our women, because a man's woman is the field which produces your nation. If you don't protect your field, you'll produce a bad nation. A farmer goes out and studies poisons and chemicals. He sprays them on his cabbage, his beans, his corn, looking to kill any worm, any insect that he finds seeking to destroy his crop. We put scarecrows up in the field to keep the enemies of our vegetables and fruit out of our fields. We shoot one another for stealing the other one's crop. Now, how much more important is a nation's sister? How much more important is your brother, I mean your wife, your daughter, your mother, than your cabbage and your beans and your corn, when she's the field which produces your sons and daughters? How many believe that separation, respecting your women, cleaning up yourselves, respecting yourselves before others respect you, getting some land and producing your own necessities, black and white, who are for black folks doing this? Raise your hand. Now, I know all black folks are with it because that's for them. And all the white folks didn't raise your hand. That means you admit integration ain't going to do it. I'm going to give you one more chance. All believe separation and black folks doing for self is solution. Raise your hand. Maybe you didn't think. Those are the white. Okay, now no white hands up. All right, now I want you black folks to notice this. No white hands went up. This is why I'm going to see how many hypocrites we got. Integration, you know, ain't going to work, and you ain't going to have it. I know you ain't going to have it. You're because I'm the heavyweight champ of the world, and I'm one of them special niggas. But otherwise, when you leave here, you're still going to be yourself. You understand? Integration ain't going to do it, right? You know violence ain't going to do it. You know politics ain't going to do it. Now you don't want me to leave all this evil that you inflicted upon me. Now, in other words, you want me to stay a slave right here, right? And you tell me when I can be free and what I can do. Now, all them black folks to stay in the position they're in and slaves that they are, that are white, hold your hands up. And somebody lied. Some whole lot of you all are telling a whole lot of lies. That's all I want to say. Thank you. The fellow told me we were supposed to have a question and answer prayer, but I don't see why anybody could ask any questions. Couldn't be no questions because we didn't answer and asked them all. I mean, I asked them and I answered them and you didn't have no response, so it shouldn't be no question and answer prayer. How many rounds going to take me to get Frazier? Well, I'm retired from boxing, so I have no more interest in boxing, but I wrote a poem on what would have happened if I'd fought Frazier. And that poem just describes the, if I'd fought Frazier, this poem describes the first round of the fight, which would be the outcome of it. And the poem went like this. Here's what it would sound over radio. Ali comes out to meet Frazier, but Frazier starts to retreat. If Frazier goes back an inch farther, he'll wind up in a ringside seat. Ali swings to the left, Ali swings to the right. Look at the kid carry the fight. Frazier keeps backing, but there's not enough room. It's a matter of time. There Ali lowers the boom. Now Ali lands on the right. What a beautiful swing. And the punch lifts Frazier clean out of the ring.
Frazier still rising. But the referee wears a frown, for he can't start counting till Frazier comes down. Now Frazier disappears from view. The crowd is getting frantic, but our radar stations have picked him up. He's somewhere over the Atlantic. Who would have thought when they came to the fight that they would witness the launching of a colored satellite? Tell you something else
about Joe Frazier. You know, they call him Smokey Joe because he uses the term, he's going to come out smoking. You know, he says, I'm hot, I'm in condition, I'm going to be smoking when I come out. That's his old saying, you understand? So I wrote a poem on Smokey Joe. This is a short poem, and it goes like this. Joe's going to come out smoking, and I ain't going to be joking. I'll be pecking and a-poking, pouring water on his smoking. It might shock and amaze you, but I retire Frazier. But that was all campaign poems I had in case the fight ever came off, but it never came off, and I'm retired now, getting old, and I'll let the other boys fight it out. Yeah.